Welcome back to the Unshadowed podcast. In this week's episode, I'll be covering a cold case from 40 years ago that has finally been solved just this week. We are talking about the murder of West Virginia resident Cynthia Miller. Cynthia Miller was a 27-year-old schoolteacher who lived in the town of Beckley, West Virginia. She was born on August 2, 1954. Cynthia has been described by her sister as a very talented person, and one of Cynthia's former students has stated that the teacher was very dedicated to her students, often sacrificing her own free time to help students in need. Cynthia would spend her lunch periods offering extra help to her students, and she was known to stay long after school hours to help them as well. Her students seem to remember Cynthia very fondly as a teacher who cared for every student as an individual. And it didn't matter who the student was, Cynthia felt it was her mission to teach them all to the best of her ability, and she was really dedicated to helping every single one of her students succeed. Cynthia was a very religious person, and she was dedicated to her church. Among her many skills, Cynthia was super intelligent, and she had a long list of extracurricular activities, including being a part of the choir and the International Thespian Society. After graduating in 1972, Cynthia went on to attend university, where she studied education. She had not only her bachelor's degree, but her master's degree as well, which shows how determined and intelligent she really was. In 1975, Cynthia got married to a man named Michael Cole. Michael had been her friend and boyfriend for many years, and as most people do when they're young and seemingly in love, the two decided to get married. Their marriage did not live up to their expectations, and Cynthia and Michael soon started to drift apart. This tends to be common in young marriages because people evolve and change, and unfortunately, these changes do not always cause couples to grow together. Getting a divorce from Michael was something that Cynthia struggled with because it went against her faith. However, eventually the two were divorced in 1979. Although Cynthia and Michael still remained friends after they separated. Eventually, Cynthia met a man named Gary O'Neill, and the two of them later became engaged. Gary moved into Cynthia's house, but the two were not quite alone because Cynthia rented out her basement to a woman named Terry. Cynthia was working as a teacher at the middle school that she had previously attended, and she also got involved with Avon as a way to help her make a little extra money because, as we all know, teaching does not quite pay nearly enough, and most people that enter into teaching do it because they love to teach and not for the money. And I think that that was definitely true for Cynthia, and that's why she had her Avon business on the side. Cynthia seemed to have it all, a job she was passionate about, a man she loved, and she had so many aspirations for her future, including starting a family with Gary. Unfortunately, Cynthia would never get to live out this life that she had worked so hard to create for herself, because she was murdered on the night before her wedding to Gary. It is reported that Cynthia was spending the night before the wedding tying up some loose ends, and although I've never been married, I have been in several weddings, and I know that there are a million last-minute details that she was probably trying to figure out before her big day. So she was probably pretty busy with those, and I imagine that she was feeling both nervous and excited about the next day. Earlier on the 26th, Cynthia had gone to the middle school to set up her classroom for the following school year, and after running a few errands, she eventually returned home. Terry, the tenant who rented out Cynthia's basement, returned home around 8:30 p.m., and she actually needed Cynthia's help fixing the door to the basement. And so after they did that, Cynthia went to bed, and Terry hung around the house for a little bit before leaving to go help her father with something. As Cynthia went to bed, she expected her fiancé to return soon, not knowing that he would actually be running late that night. Gary had gone to Princeton to visit his parents the night before the wedding, and since he was away, he tried calling a few times to check up on his bride, probably to see how she was doing with the last-minute wedding details, and to also update her about his travels and tell her that he was actually going to be home a little bit later than scheduled. However, all of the calls that Gary made went unanswered, and he started to become quite concerned. He was actually so concerned that he rushed back to Beckley to check on Cynthia. As he returned home a little after midnight, he saw her car in the driveway, and so he was instantly relieved. But then he noticed that something was off. The front front porch light that Cynthia usually kept on for him had been turned off. Gary made it inside and immediately found Cynthia laying in a pool of her own blood. It turns out that Cynthia had been shot 4 times, and it was later determined that the weapon was a .25 caliber pistol. 2 of the shots were fired at a distance, and 2 of them were shot at a very close range. A neighbor reported what they thought to be fireworks around 9:30 p.m., and this is when the gunshots took place. The odd thing is that Terry was still home at this time, and she told police that she didn't hear or see anything. Gary actually owned a pistol just like the one that had been used to kill Cynthia, but after testing, it was ruled out and determined to not be the murder weapon. There seemed to be no motivation for the crime, because nothing was reported missing from the house, and there was no evidence of any sexual assault. The home seemed to be intact, and there was no evidence of a struggle or forced entry, which made detectives think that maybe Cynthia knew her attacker. Although detectives struggled to find any reason at all why anyone would want to harm the young bride-to-be. Gary was cleared, as he had been nearly an hour away at the time of the murder with his parents. Terry was also cleared, as well as Cynthia's ex-husband Michael. Throughout the investigation, many tips rolled in, but none of them led to any positive leads or suspects. The case eventually fell cold. That was until it was reopened in 2017. It was reported on Tuesday, October 13th of this year, that the murderer had been found. Since this is so recent, there aren't many details, but what has been revealed is that a man named Earl James Robbins has been charged with the first-degree murder of Cynthia Miller. Earl Robbins had also previously been indicted on multiple charges of kidnapping, abduction, and sexual assault, some of them involving a minor of 13 years. What we do know about Earl is that he's a 64-year-old man, and he was a prior resident of Beckley, the same town where Cynthia lived. Unfortunately, Cynthia's father passed away years before he could ever see justice earned for his daughter. Cynthia's sister has spoken about how much it tore her father apart to not know what happened to Cynthia. And even on the day of his own death, he grieved for his daughter and showed a lot of hurt over not knowing what happened to her. Which is so sad to think of a man living out his final moments, not having the closure of knowing why his daughter was taken away from him. It really did haunt him right up until the day he died. Another important person in Cynthia's life passed before he could find out what happened to her, and that is the man that she never got to marry. Gary, who worked as a police officer, eventually had 2 children of his own, and at the age of 64, he lost his battle to brain cancer in 2014. It is such a shame that 2 people who loved Cynthia so deeply never got to see justice be served for her. But for those who are still here, I'm sure it comes as such a relief to finally get some answers, and I'm curious to see what will happen with the trial. Although he had been serving a sentence in a California prison, Earl Robbins essentially got away with murder for the last 40 years, and I hope that he will get a harsh punishment for this crime. A lot of times, people seem to forget about cold cases, or they think that they're not as important as current, open cases, but this is why I think it's so crucial to tell these stories and not forget about the victims, because not only does their story matter whether it's cold or not, but in this case, Cynthia's killer was still out there and he was continuing to cause harm to other people. So it brings me a lot of relief to know that justice will be served, and I hope that others hear this story and know not to give up hope. Thank you so much for listening. I know that this case isn't entirely wrapped up, but I did want to share the update because it has been such a long time coming, and I really wanted to get Cynthia's story out there. I'll be back next week with another episode, and in the meantime, I would love it if you could subscribe to this podcast wherever you listen and give it a like if you're watching on YouTube. If you want to rate and review this podcast, I would love that as well. I also have another podcast. It's much more uplifting and it's a great balance for me considering the content I cover here. So I'll link that below, as well as my YouTube channels and other social medias. All right, thank you so much for listening, and I'll see you next week where we shed light on another case that has been in the shadows for far too long.